Hi, I'm delighted to welcome Kip Winger back to Dawn Osborne in session. Kip, let everyone know how you are.
I'm good, good. Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
Now, I was shocked to realize that it's 9 years since Better Days Coming. It just doesn't seem like that long.
It doesn't. It's been a long time. I've been very busy writing I did Get Jack, the musical, and I did a couple classical things that were took me a quite a long time, and Reb's been touring in Whitesnake, and we've done a lot of shows since then, but
Sure.
we finally the stars aligned so we could make an album.
No, so you still got the four original members from 1988 and the new guitarist that has merely been there since 1992 and is also does some of the additional harmony vocals and things like that. So actually, despite you appearing to be a very tough critic on Monsters of Rock Cruise, you must be a great boss because they've all stuck with you.
Oh, that's funny. I don't consider myself a good boss. I consider myself a good delegator. I like to bring out the best talent in everybody and let them have their moment. And I'm good at knowing what that is. So we're all really good friends, and we've never had any fights or anything like that. And we enjoy touring together. So, we're lucky because we all get along really well, and we always have.
The new album's called Seven. And again, it's quite surprising to me that there are only seven studio albums across the time that the guys have been going.
Well, you have to realize it's seven studio albums, four solo albums, and a classical album. So,
Absolutely.
and Reb has two solo albums, and so, I mean, I think we're on par. We just, we had that long hiatus where I did a lot of other stuff musically.
The new album is amazing quality. I mean, everything you do is really good. I get the feeling that you guys are perfectionists, absolute perfectionists.
Oh, well, I mean, I've always been that way. I know, I'm pretty definite about what I want to hear, and Reb and I work really well together. As far as like actually recording it. And on this album, I wanted each original member to be on every single track. So what you're hearing is every single member of the band, all five of us, playing on every single track. And even Paul Taylor played a solo on Broken Glass. He's never played a guitar solo on a Winger album. And then John Roth had two solos on One Light to Burn and Time Bomb, and John Roth and I co-wrote One Light to Burn, and there's a double solo on Stick the Knife In and Twist. And yeah, I mean, I'm not a jammer type musician. I like it all to be very orchestrated, hence my classical departure, because I grew up on 70s bands like Yes and Jethro Tull and Gentle Giant and Genesis, where everything is like very in its place and orchestrated and worked out,
Okay. Now I understand you started the new album about 6 months before COVID, but COVID delayed things. But in actual fact, across that period of time, the band's been going, 3 years is quite a quick time for a Winger album to get out.
You know what? It actually took me longer than most. Normally, like if Reb and I start an album, well, like I would just commit all my time to it. So
All right.
it would take like maybe a year total to write it and record it. But COVID definitely set us back with travel plans and restrictions and all that kind of stuff. And then also Reb did some gigs and I did some gigs and the band did some gigs. Like there was a lot of stuff going on. I was working on my first symphony. And so there was a lot of other things happening. So it actually did take us a little longer than normal, but And I also wanted to let the music like cook in the cooker for a while just to make sure I got it exactly right.
Okay, and I understand that you nobbled Desmond Child, that you happened to come across at a fantasy camp to get involved with the writing on the new single.
Yeah, I've known Desmond since I sang on Trash with Alice Cooper. We didn't know each other well, but I've always been a huge fan, and he's such a beautiful human being. And yeah, I watched a masterclass of his on Zoom about songwriting, and we exchanged numbers. And he lives in Nashville, and so I live in Nashville. And I was stuck on Proud Desperado. I was like, man, I need help on the lyrics. And I just asked him, not knowing if he would say yes, but he did. And he really helped me with that tune. Desmond Child, there's no mistaking the talent of Desmond Child. I mean, the guy's absolutely incredible.
Yeah, that Kane Roberts album, I love, which he wrote most of that. He's done a lot of things for a lot of people, hasn't he? Yeah. What is Proud Desperado about? Apparently unfulfilled dreams, but can you give us more context or detail on it?
Well, it could be about all the things we see following leaders who let you down, it could be left up to a lot of interpretation. It could be Ukraine, it could be January 6th, it could be what's happening in the Middle East, but it could also be Tom Cruise in Jack Reacher or John Wick. I mean, you know, somebody did a mashup video of John Wick, John Reacher, and James Bond. They did their own video to Proud Desperado, and it was like, I mean, because you see those movies, motion pictures, the budget was like $1 billion, and it's awesome. You know, it's really about following your dreams and being let down, basically, and feeling like you stand for something, and then being left holding the bag, kind of.
Okay, yeah. I've seen the video with all the explosions, which is like, I love the bit where you burst out and there's a massive explosion behind you. I understand there are 6 videos. Why 6 at once? That seems pretty brutal. I mean, I know you've got new technology, so that probably cuts down some of the work. And I guess you can schedule together more if you do 6 at once, but it does seem like a brutal schedule to do 6 at once.
We did 3 and 3, actually. It's tough, man, but I feel like, and I still would like to do a couple more, because I feel like all the songs deserve a visual component. Okay. And I feel like without a visual component nowadays, like, you can't, you know, most people are like visually oriented. They want to see something, you know, and I'm not really into just doing a El Cheapo lyric video. You know what I mean? I'm not opposed to lyric videos if the lyrics are like really appropriate for a lyric video. Like I actually do have a ballad on this song that would be appropriate for a lyric video, but in general, I think fans want to see the band playing the stuff, you know.
Yeah. Now, you know, obviously
I made, sorry, John, sorry to interrupt you. I made 6. It doesn't mean anyone's going to watch them, you know. So watch those videos.
Yeah, watch those videos. Watch those videos.
Coming out soon, actually.
Which one is the next one?
I'm not telling.
Oh, well, I was hoping you would.
When's this interview coming out?
I'm going to put it out later today.
Oh, well.
On video. So it's too soon.
I haven't approved my announcing that with the label, but okay. It's coming soon.
Okay. On radio, it's going to be after release, but the first version of this is going out very soon. Now you mentioned, your background of classical, so Grammy nominated involvement with ballet, even as a performer. So it is quite interesting to contrast that with the image that Winger had in the beginning, which was that macho image that Steel Panther parody, with the actual sophistication behind the scenes. And, you know, the Winger songs are deceptively deep as well and complicated musically. So a bit like a mathematical equation. It seems obvious, but if it was obvious, why didn't other people come up with it first? And also, you can't see the working behind the scenes.
Wow, you just said it all right there. Thank you very much for getting that. I really appreciate that. I have no idea what question you asked me, but what you said was very profound. I appreciate you noticing that, because I always try to put a lot into this music, and even 17, which the lyric is very tongue in, excuse me, which is very tongue in cheek. There's a lot going on under the hood there. What was the second half of the question?
Well, it wasn't really a question. It was sort of an observation and seeing if you agreed with me on it, which, you know, sure. Clearly.
I totally do. And I appreciate that. But Steel Panther, it's kind of the same with them, because Satchel's an incredible guitar player. It's not like those guys can't do what they do. It's not like... You know, they're really, really excellent at each individual thing. You know, the drummer, the bass player, the guitar player—they're all really good. So it's a funny similar situation. That's why I was so excited to do a pairing with those guys in the UK for this tour coming up.
Yeah, it's coming up in May. You're going to be special guests to Steel Panther, and so people could go out and get tickets to that, and I should be coming along to that. Hope to be reviewing and photographing, I understand, so I should be there. Sticking with the album, you've said it's a blend of the first and the third records. I think the main difference is probably the modern production now, and also subject matter of the lyrics. I feel that the lyrics are somewhat less rosy, maybe with life experience. That's what life experience does to all of us.
Man, you totally get it. I appreciate you understanding that. I mean, I'm not a lot of people have a perception about Winger and Kip Winger, and I'm usually, in most cases, not what people perceive me to be that way. And so... I tried to make lyrics that spoke personally to me, but also about in a way that I think a lot of people experience life in general. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. On a deeper level, like a more contemplative level. There's no real party songs on this album, you know, but Winger was never really a party band. We did a couple songs like that, but if you listen to from the second record on, we were a very serious band.
Sure.
And a lot of people that know me think I'm a little bit too serious. So, but thank you for noticing that. Yeah, I tried to, and by the way, I don't enjoy lyrics. I really, it's torture, but I tried to elevate the subject matter and the depth of content. Yeah.
Okay. Talking about Steel Panther and you touring with them, I think it shows that you're actually quite secure in yourself to actually go on a tour with Steel Panther, given that, you know, the 80s bands are sort of the butt of the joke. And I find it particularly surprising, given what happened with you with Beavis and Butthead, you know, because that did hurt. And, you know, obviously you've managed to get, you know, a tough exterior, a tough skin as a result of all of that, to be able to go and do that. There would be some 80s bands that wouldn't consider going on a tour with Steel Panther.
Well, first of all, I love those guys. As people, they're really awesome. And secondly, okay. I'm a fan. And thirdly, I say this a lot, and I don't mean it as a bragging thing. I feel like when I got nominated for a Grammy Contemporary Classical Composition, I felt like, okay, well, that basically set the record straight. I mean, I don't need to make excuses or any of that stuff. I mean, that says it right there. I don't need to prove myself to anybody. I just, I'm confident in what we do. The musicians in my band are great, and I know my level as a musician, so I don't need to, I don't feel insecure about it. I think it's fun, and I think it's actually a really interesting juxtaposition to be the band, the type of band that Steel Panther parodies. And so the audience can get this full view of this thing with all original members, by the way. I just think that for the people that are going to see the concert, it's going to be a very, very unique experience to see that, you know.
And another testimony to the quality is the fact that I believe you're working nonstop to the end of the year. Like, you're literally going to be going at it. And, you know, I understand that the technique of falsetto forces a lot of air through the vocal cords. It's actually harder on the vocal cords than a lot of other techniques. And you're going to need a lot of stamina to get through all of that.
Yeah, you know, I'm terrified. I mean, it, the more I do this, the more I don't want to be the guy on stage going, oh, with the audience, like, oh, he can't sing anymore. I can still hit all the notes. Sometimes I have a few bad nights. You know, the human voice, it's not like you can change strings and go down, 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 ready to go, you know. You never know what's going to come out. Any singer you ask will say the same thing. You go out there wondering what's going to happen. I just try to stay in shape. It's like kind of like stay in shape or a marathon, to be honest with you. And I've had trouble with my voice on and off over the last 5 years. Many people have seen it. Usually by the end of the set, I'm good. But yeah, I mean, that's definitely, I'm concerned about it in terms of just not wanting to let the fans down, you know.
Yeah. But you do go to the gym every morning. So, you know, I think it's important to focus on absolutely every aspect of your lifestyle to try and keep yourself in shape.
I go to the gym every morning religiously, and I'm one of these singers that warms up, you know. We got, you know, there's a few of us out there, like Robert Mason, me, and we're classically trained, you know. So we know the basic techniques to keep the mechanism running right. Like if a doctor stuck a camera down my throat, which they have several times, it's kind of like, you know, oh, your vocal cords are like you're 20 years old, so no damage or anything. It's just really difficult to keep it up as you get older, because the wear and tear, you know.
It's good to know they're in good shape.
Thank you. There's a lot of guys out there that are having trouble, and I feel their pain. I mean, I really feel their pain. I feel really, you see singers that are not doing it, and it's like, I feel their pain.
And you, really, that's certainly not the case for you, because usually you blow people away on Mork and on your Borderline shows that, you know, you used to do before the pandemic. I guess they've bitten the dust, haven't they, because of the pandemic.
I miss the Borderline. You know, they sold the Borderline and turned it into a disco. That was really like my home. I really, really miss that place. I did one last year, 2 years ago, that just wasn't the same. The people were the same, but the venue, I got to find a better venue. I got to find a new venue to do my annual show. Cause I really, that was always one of the, I look more forward to that gig than almost any gig I do.
Oh, well, we will have to find another place for you. And I understand it's going to be like brothers on a bus, cause you guys are going to be doing a bus tour with Tom Kiefer. And you haven't been on a bus doing like a multi-venue tour for a long time.
No, I haven't been on a bus for a long time, and I swore I'd never do it again.
rather you than me, actually, I must admit. But you're not going to give in and do hotels and everything. You're going to stick with it.
Well, the nature of the tour demands being on a bus. So, I mean, there's nothing, you know, the main thing for me, I love the bus, actually. I just don't like sleeping in that little coffin.
Absolutely. One of the things that I always thought was very cool about you was that you chose to live in Santa Fe And I spent a lot of time traveling around the Southwest when I was younger, and I'd be going there again. Probably I've stopped a little bit because of the pandemic. But the only thing was, the last time I went, the pandemic had really taken its toll on and a lot of the old shops had closed. Some of the shopkeepers had died, and I used to collect the genuine turquoise jewelry, not the blue crap, that they sell most people. But like those kind of things have, they disappeared a little bit. But you live in Nashville now, you made that move because of music industry reasons, did you?
Well, yeah, I did. I for several reasons there. I had some, tragedy in Santa Fe, and I felt like it was a time to move there for some fresh, blood. I had some work to do in Nashville with a person from Sony, and I just felt like I needed a change. And I was one of the first guys. I think Tom Kiefer was really like the first real rocker to move to Nashville, but, and now it's like all the rage. Everybody goes
Yeah,
there.
absolutely,
I
absolutely.
tell you, honestly, I've never felt at home there. And I'm looking for somewhere to go now, but I don't know where to go because, Santa Fe was incredible. I'd love to go back there, but the other reason I left Santa Fe was that I had really intense allergies.
Ah, because it's in the mountains, it's up, it's high, it's cold.
Juniper trees, man. If you're allergic to juniper, it's like having the flu 6 months a year. It's awful.
Oh, right. Okay. Can I ask about your nails? Because you have the inc most incredible nails that I've noticed, for example, in the lift on the Monsters of Rock cruise. They're like really long. How do you stop them splitting? Because they must get some quite a lot of punishment because, all the ladies want to know how we can keep our nails that long.
Man, they're it's acrylic. They're not there now. It's acrylic.
Oh, right. You add them.
Oh yeah, big time. Well, on my picking hand, because it's
Oh, okay. I wondered how the hell you'd grew natural nails that long. Well, they look good anyway. They look good enough to be real. Oh, I'm glad I asked that question. A secret now.
they don't do them like I do them. They don't do I use forms and acrylic, and now they want to put tips on, and tips don't work, and they're bent, so it's weird. I have a woman that I've been going to for 15 years now, who really knows. I mean, I trained her for that. They have to be flat, and they have to be a certain way so you can play with them,
Now, I'm going to be seeing you soon on Mork. You're known for two things on Mork, apart from the wonderful music, of course. I'm getting into jokey territory now. You're known for the late night gambling, which I never see because I get up and do the early morning activities. I'm absolutely crushed by the last band and I go to bed straight away. So I never see the late night gambling. But also being a really, really tough critic. Where does that come from? Because it's you it is it's quite confrontational sometimes, your style when you're because it's not exactly, some people say it's not what you say, it's how you say it, but you have a particular style of your own.
Man, it all started the first they asked me to be a judge on So You Think You Can Shred, and I was watching these guitar players and they were terrible, man. And I was just like, well, Simon Cowell didn't have a problem saying it. I just thought everybody's over here being all nice and stuff, and it's like, okay, that's really good, but does that really help anyone? Like, oh yeah, it's great, man, I'll give you a 8.5, And I'm like,
That sounds
what are you
like
guys
Joel
talking
Hoekstra.
about? I mean, these guys are all, and I'm like, what are you talking about? This is terrible. Like, you suck, And
I see your point because they're never going to get.
no one better than me to say somebody sucks, because I took "you suck" more than anybody in the music business. So, why not?
Oh, yeah, that Beavis and Butthead thing, you deserve a medal for everything that happened there. Yeah, you've got a tough, so you expect other people to be tough. I agree with you. I think that if people don't know they've got to improve, they will never improve. So I see it differently now. I'm glad I asked you. You love the visual. Have you never thought about doing anything in film or anything like that, or you just don't have time?
Oh, I'm a Tom Cruise, Keanu Reeves groupie. I mean, I like, are you kidding me? If I could act, I wouldn't change doing what I do, because composing music is really my deepest thing. But of course, it'd be doing a character part in a movie. That would be amazing. But I can't act. I mean, I'm terrible. You know, I did a little acting when I had a little 6-month stint at University of Denver when I was 19. And, you know, I was terrible.
I was thinking about directing and producing, actually, you know, because of your mind with, you know, moving parts and making everything in its place. That's what I was thinking, actually.
Oh, well, that would be awesome. And I actually have something that I'm working on right now that could be quite interesting, but it's too early to tell. But I'm fascinated in that, definitely.
So do you have any other projects you can tell us about? What's next for you?
The same thing I've been saying. I'm writing a violin concerto for Nashville Symphony that's going to pair with my first symphony that premiered last March for an album on Naxos. And it's kicking my ass. What can I say? I've got 16 minutes and I need 24 minutes. And I'm panicking about the last 8 minutes because 8 minutes of that music could take a year, you know.
Talking about time, we have come to the end of our slot. Kip, thank you very much for making some time to talk to us.
Great to see you. I'll see you on the cruise.
See you on the cruise.
Bye.
Bye.